Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Torment, Tides of Numenera. In the last episode, well, quite a lot of things happened, actually. Where should I start? And where should I start from? Well, maybe from the beginning. So we found our way to the Bloom's Heart, and we managed to save Ishen from there. However, it turned out that Ishen was Masov the whole time. And in case you don't remember who Masov is, he's a fellow castoff we met and talked to once through a mere caster back in Miel Avest before the Bloom attacked.
Before someone tries to kill me.
Yeah. Shut up now. So anyway, we saved Masov and brought him back to the Memovira, who also turned out to be the first castoff herself. So she was not completely honest with us, and kind of tricked us to get Masov back to her for free, basically. But personally, I don't mind. The main thing is that we found her, and we needed Masov anyway to operate the resonance chamber. But anywho, so the first castoff had her own plans for the resonance chamber, and what she was basically planning to use the resonance chamber and to cut our ties to the tides. However, she doesn't seem to know that if our connection to the tides is cut, we die. Because we are that dependent on the tides, or at least that's what.
Is kind of nice, relaxing.
Well, that's nice. But could you be quiet for a little while? So, but anyway, what was I about to say? She broke my train of thought. Oh yeah. Although one of our fellow castoffs back in Miel Avest, which was the sanctuary of all castoffs, said that we are so dependent on the tides that if we lose the connection to the tides, we die. I don't remember his name anymore, but he was the founder of the Dendra Ahur cult, the cult of people who, you know, ate dead corpses and bodies to learn their life experiences and knowledge and all that stuff. And according to him, we are so dependent on the tides that if we lose that connection, we die. But the first castoff either didn't know that, or she didn't believe it. Yeah. Shut up. Well, but yeah, I was trying to stop her, but then I realized that there's like, I don't know, 5-6 people against us three, and they were not just some random thugs or weak cultists or anything. It was the first freaking castoff herself, and Pyrekin, who was the commander of the first castoff's troops back in Miel Avest, and whom we met there, and there were some other guys as well, also fellow castoffs. I'm quite sure.
Yes.
So I decided that you know what? Fuck it. Let's see what happens. If we die, then we can always reload the game. And well, they activated the resonant chamber, and surprise, surprise, the bloom him or her or itself appeared and attacked us. And I was about to fight that thing because I got some special powers from the resonant chamber, and I did some damage to it. But then suddenly everything went black, and here we are, and now we are inside our mind.
I'm going.
And according to this lady here, whom I don't know who she is, but there she was. But anyway, she said, from what I understood, all the consciousnesses of all living castoffs are now inside my mind because of the resonant chamber was activated, and now their bodies are dead, as far as I understood, but their minds are stored in my own mind right now. I could be wrong, but that's how I understood it anyway. And as for our current quest, the right to exist. The resonant chamber has trapped me and all the other castoffs in the labyrinth. Yeah, to my mind, in other words. The ghostly woman says the true resonance is in the deepest part of my mind. I have to get there before the specter and the Spectre is a changing guard, in case you remember. If I want to decide the fate of the castoffs, the Spectre is on his way to the Resonance. I have to get there first to stop him from subsuming all our minds into his. Now, at least I'm quite sure that the Spectre is the changing guard who has been hiding in the labyrinth all this time. So he's also planning to stop the sorrow by basically training the consciousnesses of all castoffs into his own. But at the same time, we would not exist anymore. So we would basically die. So our quest now is to stop him, and well, I don't know what else we can do, but we'll see. And you might be also wondering, who is this? Well, believe it or not, but this is Rhin. Yes, that small girl we helped to get back home a few episodes ago or so, and now she's all grown up and badass. And just look at her freaking stats, here. Oh my freaking god, she's a badass. And she also got lots of cool abilities here. I especially like this hiding and healing. Heals 20 points of health on all allies in range of target point. That's so freaking nice. I don't know what happened to Matskina and Tybir though. Well, Matskina's consciousness should still be in the labyrinth somewhere, because she's also a castoff. But Tybir, I don't know. And to be honest, I don't really care. Tybir never really impressed me, at least not when it comes to combat, or even as much as a character either, so I don't care. I would rather have Aligurd or Eridus back from Sakus Cliffs. I wonder if we can ever get there. But yeah, Rhin is back, and she's all grown up and stuff. How did she get to the labyrinth in the first place? And is she from the future or from another dimension? I don't know, and I don't care. But the main thing is that we got Rhin back, and she certainly remembers us. Oh, by the way, what is this? Dual Shin cannot be unequipped, only usable by Rhin. Rhin says this is another of her guards. It looks like a regular coin to you. Well, alright, but it doesn't do anything by the looks of it. And what does this do? In every way that matters, this is a rock with a hole in it, yet Rhin talks to it frequently. Another one of her guards, I take it. Well, I don't know. But whatever the case, I have been rambling enough already. So, we have an option to go to this portal where the changing guard, or the Spectre, is right now, trying to reach the Resonance. And there's also four other portals. Kreftum Phantom, Village Phantom, Osis Phantom, and Clock Phantom. I don't know what these are supposed to be. At first, I thought that this would be portals back to some other previous locations we have already visited, like Sakus Cliffs, the Necropolis, and so on. But I don't know. And to be honest, I don't think if I should go visit those places right now. So what I was thinking that let's just go and try to stop the Spectre. So without further ado, let's go. I'm sure that I and Rhin can take care of ourselves, assuming that the Spectre is alone. If not, then things might get a bit complicated. Maybe we can find Maxina. Possibly. I mean, we did find wait, who are these? Is this an endless battle? Well, shit. Raima Siro. The glaive you met in Mil Avest stares at you with wild fury and no sense of recognition, as though you were her most hated enemy. Another one? You have come too late to help the traitors. Kill her too. Raima Siro. Oh yeah, she was one of those... She was one of those castoffs who were arguing in Mil Avest, and she was with the Sire. The changing god, in other words. I won't fight my brothers and sisters. You are trapped in an illusion, Raima. None of this is real. Although, what would happen if we surrendered? Nothing good, I would take it, so let's see if we can convince her that this is not real. Deceitful as the first herself, my mind is clear, and I see you for the avaricious... Jesus Christ, some of these words. Avaricious liar you are. Well, of course we have to fight. Well, at least we can now test that just how good Rhin actually is. So what could she do again? Cipher adept. Conserve the next cipher used, allowing it to be used a second time. Cannot be used with items that spend permanent bonuses, obviously, but you don't seem to have anything on you. Quantum step. Teleport one ally to a point within range. Yeah, interesting. Hide. And animate Balefire. This was very cool. Summon a construct that draws the attacks of all nearby enemies and fights on your side. This character can only summon one animate Balefire at a time. Active entire crisis. That sounds very awesome. Space warp impulse that pulses or pulls all creatures in range. Bloody and Bell deals 10 relativistic damage, which ignores armor, to all enemies in range who fail to resist. Even on a miss, deals 1 relativistic damage. So that's nice. And then the healing. I think we should do... Let's try this. So, I don't know, let's make it there. Holy crap, that looks so badass. So freaking badass. And I can't attack, of course not. Let's see if... Well, at least he seems to be much more useful than the illusionary warrior ever was. And I got all the items on me. Maybe I should give some to Rhin after this. Assuming that I survive. Well, of course I survive. Let's just teleport to her. And then we attack. We don't even need to spend any points. Well, let's just go with 70%. Nice. Oh, and one of the other castoffs who... What was her name again? It was the lady... I don't remember her name anymore, but that merchant from Mil Avest is also in our... In the labyrinth, in the place where we just left, and she had lots of cool stuff, and we didn't even need to pay her anything. We just got all of her stuff for free, including this badass sword that I'm wielding right now. That looks so fucking awesome, and many other cool items. Now I guess I should. Let's see how much damage you can do. Holy crap, I don't need to spend any points. She got 15 speed points. And as I look at it, she got 15 speed points, 15 intellect points, but she doesn't have lots of might because she's a ranged character, obviously. But holy crap, we can do 100% and not even spend one single freaking speed point. Nice. Well, I don't know about you. I don't know. That seemed to be very effective to me. Let's just walk a little bit closer. That one is going to die very soon. Let's see. Maybe energy will work on this. Let's go with 70. I hope we are not, you know, ultimately killing them. Like, permanently. I hope we are not, But if we are, then it can't be helped. They attacked us. They didn't give us much of a choice. And Baleful is dead, but doesn't matter. Can we summon it again? Maybe we should go a bit closer first. Let's summon it again. Alright, now kill some stuff.
I'm barely hurting it.
Then let's not waste any might points in this fight. We are doing very well so far. Maybe I should use this so I can teleport behind them and deal some damage. Let's just go with 55%. Nice. Now these guys suck. Well, okay, they can deal some nice amount of damage. I guess we should take this one down first because he seems to be dealing a lot of damage. What else did we have here again? Uh-huh. Alright. Let's just attack this one. 100%, here we go.
Wasn't very effective.
And come a bit closer.
I'm surrounded!
I guess, should we try to kill this one? I guess we should, after all. I guess we have to spend at least a couple of points. I mean, wait a minute, do I even have... How many might potions do we have? This gives three and this gives six. Alright, well, I guess I can sacrifice a little point, a little amount of points here.
There we go.
Nah, no point. Let's just end our turn. Now let's try to focus this one down. Now that hurt. That hurt a lot. Defeat Rhymer or find a way to free her from the labyrinth's illusion. Well, goddammit, maybe I really should have paid more attention to this objective here, but I was so focused on the fight. Well, oh, what? I didn't want to go there! Well, shit. Ah, shit. Well, what's done is done. Well, maybe I should just teleport back there. I would like to hit both of those, both of these two, but it looks like I can't. Actually, you know what? Never mind, let's just leave here. Let's just stay here. But goddammit, I'm a little annoyed now that I went and killed Rhymer without paying any attention to this damn objective. Fuck. Wasn't very effective, but we killed him anyway, and that's what matters. And then he fell too. Alright, and so that was that. Now let's pick up all the loot. Ah, Rhymer. God damn it. I really should have tried to save you, but I was too blind. Too blind to see the damn freaking objective. I'm very annoyed. I'm also very tempted to just reload the damn save and try to save her, but nope. I'm gonna live with the consequences. What's done is done. Oh fuck, there's more. Andronus. Isn't he on the first cast-off site? Ready. It's the ancients of our coward sire. Hold the line, remember the Nano's fate and avoid the pylons. Well, maybe I can at least save him. Defeat, free or incapitate Andronus' squad. Whose turn is it? Oh, it's ours, alright. Rhin's, that is. Let's just summon another Bale. He can keep these guys busy. How could I talk to these guys again? Like this? You're not an agent of the Creator. I remember you from Miel Avest. As he speaks, the illusion falters, losing its grip. Oh, it was that easy. He looks around at the battle around him. This isn't the endless battle. What's wrong with all of them? He doesn't wait for your answer. It doesn't matter. I help you in any way I can. Well, goddammit, if only I realized to do that earlier with Rhyme, I could have saved them both. I'm so pissed right now. Really? And I guess... I guess I won't be attacking. He killed him. Well, that was a pointless teleport. Didn't even hurt me.
There we go.
Why did you shoot them? Why can't I summon it? Consumes action, but I haven't even done anything yet. Well, I don't know. I don't know. I guess I could... Oh wait, no. Let's go and try to talk to her.
Ready to take on the world.
The Jack stares at you with dead eyes, completely lost in the illusion that he's fighting the endless battle and you are the enemy. You know, I kind of hope that I die now, so I have the excuse to go and try that Rhyma encounter again and save her. I kind of hope that I die at some point, but of course I try not to die. I just, yeah, still a bit pissed, but enough about that. Wait, why can't you talk to? It's our turn, right? Yeah, it's supposed to be our turn, but why can't I talk to these people? Well, I can. Oh, Zerion Daywalker. I can talk to him. He looks at you without recognition or emotion. Title search: use the ties to wrench Zeria free from the illusion, or this is an illusion, Zerion. Ask the dead if you don't believe me. Punch him in the jaw. Well, let's go this. Powerful force strikes him, causing him to stagger backwards. Then he blinks. He gives you an odd look, cocking his head to one side. Interesting, is all he says before he begins to fade away to some other part of the labyrinth. Okay. Holy crap.
Just what I need.
Don't hurt Rhin, you bitch! So, I don't seem to have an option to actually talk to these people for some reason. So fuck it. Let's fuck them up. Besides, they hurt my poor Rhin. Well, not poor Rhin, but they hurt her anyway. There we go, and let's just fuck him up. There we go. Thank you for freeing me. Well, yeah, you're welcome. And we got this. That's nice. All right, I guess we continue forward. But wait, is there anything else we can do? What's this anyway? This castoff is trapped in some kind of stasis. The energy fields linked to the enormous machine next to him. Oh, there's a castoff in there.
Yes.
Oh, I didn't even know this. I just thought it was some sort of strange machine. Alright, but I can't interact with it or anything, but what about this? This strange machine vibrates, humming almost below the register you can hear. Every few seconds, it ripples and an arc of energy spits across the space between this pylon and the enormous tower nearby. A small control panel glows in the side of the machine. With no enemies around, there seems little point in wasting time with this device. You leave it alone. Ah, so I could have used this against Andronus and his friends there, if I wanted. It's over, castoff. Surrender or our father's will resist and I'll destroy you. The Calcadon. Oh yeah, we also met him in Miel Avest. He was some sort of commander of the Changing Gods forces. Defeat the Calcadon or find a way to open the cave door. So we don't have the option to actually save him or free him. All right, kind of shame. But what can you do? Let's just summon this bad boy. Wait. By the way, how far can you... Ah, so you can run that far away and still use an ability. Alright, let's run there. And then, let's summon a bell right in front of them. Nice. That bell is so freaking useful. Oh, he joined us too. Alright. Fine by me. And I guess we should... I guess we can run here and then teleport somewhere in between them. Well, here should be good. This is going with 65.
What do you think of this?
Nice. Well, that build didn't last long. Oh, Jesus Christ, that hurt. That hurt, bitch. But I can't summon this now anyway. I guess I should... Oh, holy shit, this is a big radius. But I wonder, should I use this? What does this do again? Or maybe... I think we should just focus this one down real fast. I trust her to survive and to the next turn. Plus he's coming to help us as well.
Much better.
And then we just go and fuck him up. And just to be safe. I don't want Rhin to get hurt. There we go. Ouch. Now I think I should use the healing ability.
Thank you.
Nice, that is so fucking good. Maybe OP even. Is there any limits on how many times I can use this? Action, and wait, is there... Does it say anywhere if I can use this more than once in combat? Wait, Rhin can call on his power to surround her. Alright, there must be a typo there. It says him. It's referring to him as, or her as he, even though it's a she. Alright, but there doesn't seem to be, I don't see any limitations that you can use it only once per crisis or anything, so that's good. And he fell down fast. And then... we just fucked this one up. And in turn... He does a lot of damage though. Ah, so there is no limits. Alright, nice. Yeah, I think I can just... But then again, no point to heal, so let's just attack. Nice, and one more hit and he's fucked. There we go, and... There we go. And the door opens. And did he drop anything nice? What's this? Staff of Snakes. Deal 35 relativistic damage which ignores armor and confirms hubble to all enemies in range. Ah, it's a cipher, alright.
These ciphers are killing me.
Alright, so let's give a cipher away. So what can we give away? Maybe we should give this to Rhin. Yeah, and she can use 11 damn ciphers. So that's cool. I think we are good here.
Alright, here we go.
Are you coming? I guess not. Well, let's leave then. But goddammit, I still feel kind of annoyed that I killed Rhyma without trying to save her. Well, what's on his son? Ah, the changing god. There you are. And the first are here. And it seems that, like they are arguing. So what do you have to say for yourself, sire, father? You have walked into the middle of an argument. Neither of the speakers acknowledges your presence. Their concentration is fully engaged with the other. One of them looks like Antronus, the castoff from Miel Aves, but he carries himself very differently. Confident. Haughty. This must be Antronus before he was cast off. The other is the first castoff as he saw her in the Memovira's fortress, but noticeably less scarred and beaten. A younger version. So is this, some sort of, What's the word that I'm what I'm looking for? A vision. A vision from the past or something. No, Mararel, Antronus, or rather the changing god, says, I gave you my reasons, and I have had enough of explaining myself to you. Her eyes burn through the blank stare of her porcelain mask. I have aided you in your researches, uncovered secrets of the tides you never knew, would never have figured on your own. I'm twice the thinker you are. You are an accident. I don't deny the advantages your awareness provides, but do not design to suggest we are anything like equals. Let's say nothing for now. The changing god shrugs, supremely uninterested in her reaction. You are a part of me. That's forgotten itself. You'll see. When I gather you back, all of you, and restore my daughter, then everything will be clear. You'll have that new body. Mine. He frowns. But right now, Mararel, you are interrupting me. You are distracting me from my work. Her voice heavy with frustration, wrath and pleading. They call you a god, but your divinity is a joke. You lied to me. You never intended to get me a new body, did you? You were going to let me help you as long as you needed. And then you were going to cast me aside. Just like you cast my body aside when you were done with it. And for what? The changing god has a daughter. I thought that by daughter he meant as some of his female castoffs. She snarls. You have a daughter right here. The one you are talking about has been dead for centuries. But I am flesh and blood. I am alive and begging for your help to stay that way. The look of empathy and compassion has disappeared from his face. You are not my daughter. You are a creation. You are a shell. Do you feel shame when you discard your old clothes? Do you feel pity when a doll burns? He points at her face. I feel as much connection to you as I do that mask. Well, that's a bit harsh, comparing us to pieces of cloth and dolls. I don't hate you, Mararel, his tone softens. I don't despise you, but you need to look at this from my perspective. He gestures around. All of this equipment, all of the castoffs, they are all just byproducts of what I began long ago. I must finish what I started. How will you finish what you started? How will you finish it? How will you finish what you started? She whispers. The sorrow hunts us because of what you have done. I know that. Gods! He rubs his fingers angry over his head. The sorrow is an unfortunate byproduct of my work. You know that. So my solution is simple. I'm going to find a way to bring you all back into myself. My mind will be whole again, and whatever evil the sorrow thinks I have done will be put to rest. It will leave us alone forever. Not us. You. If you suck us into your head, we will no longer exist. She shakes her head. I won't let you. We will find another way. He laughs, not scornfully, but as if she has said something genuinely hilarious. How? How will you find a solution that has eluded me? By definition, you cannot. So what do we have here? I don't care what you think. This life is mine. I will choose how to live it. My body is in the bloom. This is all an illusion, and I won't be part of it anymore. Your last castoff believes in what I'm doing. I no longer need your approval. Your last castoff, that's supposed to be us, right? Oh wait, are we talking to her or what the hell's going on here? Your last castoff believes in what I'm doing. I no longer need your approval. This kind of sounds like we are talking to the first castoff, Mararel, right here. You are right. We are just pieces of your mind. I'm sorry I ever doubted you. No, screw that. I like this one. I don't care what you think. This life is mine. I will choose how to live it. I don't care what you think, she says with conviction. This life is mine, and I will choose how to live it. As soon as she speaks the words, something snaps in the air.
I'm ready to learn something new.
Ah, and I got a level. She blinks several times, her eyes suddenly clear. The illusion is shattered. She startles and gapes at you. The changing god's avatar dissolves into dust and memory, as if it had never existed at all. A portal opens where he stood, beckoning you further into the labyrinth. Its grasp is undeniable. Okay. The first castoff crosses her arms and regards you quietly for a moment. Why did you choose to save me from that? Well, I didn't really choose to save you specifically, but I just like the option. I do like to live how I want. I said what I thought was the truth. I needed to activate the portal, so no problem was the way to do it. Well, how could I have known that? It was the right thing to do. Well, I said what I thought was the truth. Is that so? She puts a hand onto her chin, considering. Doesn't matter, nothing has changed. Then she turns abruptly and strides onto the portal. Without turning around, she says, "Thank you." Then in a brief flicker of light, she's gone. And I guess we just follow her. Placeholder loading screen. So we are in some other part of the labyrinth now. There's the resonant chamber. And of course we can't get to it. At least, not yet anyway.
Let's go all. Show them what we've learned.
What the hell am I supposed to do here?
Let's go.
What is this thing? The dominating image on this panel is a map on the map of the room. Five platforms in a circle around the central platform. It looks like controls to raise the floors, connecting the various platforms. Deep cracks radiate out from three different places, as though someone had smashed the panel in a hurried rage. The controls are unresponsive. And yet you feel something. The floors are like those in the deep fathom, where you first awoke after your fatal fall. The platforms as well as this control panel are mental construct like anything else here. They should respond to your will, if you just exert it. Focus your will on the floors of this fathom, command them to rise. You stretch out your mind, trying to feel the tides flowing through this place. You can certainly feel their energies, but the floors remain stubbornly inert. Apparently it won't be that easy. Well, let's use tidal forces then. The tides around you, swirling throughout the entirety of this place. You exert your will, pushing power through those channels and into the control panel. Even as you watch, the glass reshapes itself, the cracks healing as though they were never there. With a hum and a chitter, the controls come to life. The platform you are standing on pulses with an orange glow, showing the floors in their current state. Touching the platform on the screen should shift the floors. Well, that was rather easy. A familiar voice echoes from the depths below. You are still here, then. I had hoped the labyrinth would trap your mind as well, but apparently I made your body too well. But you don't have enough power to stop me. You are practically alone in a place I created for you. It's the height of arrogance, you know that? You have no hope of surviving this. Go ahead, solve your puzzles. It won't matter. In a little while, you'll be nothing more than a whiff of nostalgia in my mind. The voice fades to nothing. Screw you, changing god. And guess we just have to do the same thing to this panel as well. The map on this control panel is fully functional. The platform you are standing on pulses with an orange glow, showing the floors in their current state. Touching the platform on the screen should shift the floors. Well, let's do that then. With a hum and rattle, pylons rise and fall from the depths, changing the shape of the room.
I'm on it.
And then this opens up, a way to this platform, I take it. The map on this control panel is fully functional. The platform you're standing on pulses with an orange glow. So it's... Oh wait, is it different? Touching the platform on the screen should shift the floors. There's an extra image here that was not visible on the other panels. A human figure in dotted outline. It flickers erratically as though something were wrong with it. Well, let's see what that is. As you place your hand on it, something activates within the panel. not just this panel, but every panel in the room. The circular stations on every platform glow, and the image of the human figure begins to pulse regularly, as though waiting for input. Press to pulse the image of the human figure. Let's try that. Tiny needles puncture your fingers. There is a flash from the circular sit plate next to the panel, and a finger-long blade in its center starts spinning and humming around its axis. As it spins, it projects a three-dimensional image very similar to yourself. Your own body flickers in and out of phase. The blade spins faster, brighter. Your body's flickering accelerates until finally the blade dissolves, and standing on the platform is fully grown human that looks remarkably like you. Okay. The figure before you looks almost exactly like you, but a man instead of a woman. Maybe that's the male character we could have played as if we chose to play as a male. He doesn't bear your scars, but otherwise his face is like a mirror. Hello, he says pleasantly. You must be me. Who are you? Well, I'm a short-lived version of you. He looks you up and down. Basically, our creator used these cloning stations to rapidly prototype different body types and features before deciding on a final shell for his consciousness. He looks at the control panel. These look different from the controls I remember. It looks like I'm stuck on the most recent settings. He flashes you a smile. Not that that is a bad thing, of course. I'm sure you wouldn't mind. How long do you last? Only a few minutes, give or take. God damn it! I wish I could take you with me. Catching your look, he adds. It's not so bad. It doesn't hurt. At least I don't remember it hurting. If you only live a short time, how do you know all of this? Oh, that's the most interesting part. Our creator always liked to process things externally, to have someone to talk to. He constructed assistants all the time. I was unable to maintain my memories from version to version. That way I could provide more useful feedback on how one body moved or felt compared to another. Our progenitor would even have me perform tasks from time to time, sometimes mundane, sometimes dangerous. The fact that I could learn from my mistakes was a great help. If you are me, then why you are a man? He laughs. Our progenitor was funny like that. Gender for the next self was always a last-minute decision. Our creator was never content with one or even two genders. It was a fungible thing. He would constantly explore and experiment, even trying Varjelen, Kibra, and Jiruk bodies at different points. He stops, looking more thoughtful. You know, even after centuries with our creator, I can't explain the fastidiousness about gender. It's just the way he is. Fastidiousness? I have no freaking idea what this word is supposed to mean. Do you know what this place is? He looks around. I thought it was the cloning laboratory where prototype bodies were tested, but this doesn't look right at all. Where's the floor? The walls? All the equipment here is here, but... He looks back at you. It's like a nightmare version of the laboratory, I know. As if somebody described the lab to a visitant that didn't quite understand it all, and then that visitant tried to recreate it. He shakes his head. I don't know. Could you perform a task for me? Like walk to the other station and tackle the floors? He gives you a funny look but says, sure, I can do that. Thanks, dude. Oh, crap, and then he just exploded. Although... Shit.
Yes, now.
Maybe I should have tried to give that command to him when I was here. Let's just connect the platform to the left. And leave it.
Absolutely.
And then here, hopefully we can connect the platform to this resonant chamber here and see who's inside there. Or you brace yourself this time. The needles puncture your fingers again, and the blades begin spinning. Your own body flickers and in and out of existence. Soon the process is complete, and your clone stands on the platform watching you. Well, hello there. Hello again, sister. Can I help you with something? All right. I need you to tackle the floors at the other station again. Sure, why not? Now this time, let's hope that I get to the resonant chamber. That looks so brutal. Yes. Oh, for the love of... Fine. This makes a path. Yeah, it makes path there. How about our left? Ah, there we go. What? Ah, shit. What the? You gotta be kidding me. Arrow energy from the portal blasts the floors back into the depths. You are able to reconnect them to the platform across the fathom, but not to the exit. You'll have to find another way to reach it. Well, god damn it. Let's try this one again. Alright, let's get our clone here. I need you to toggle that other station again. Hopefully this one will work. Not quite, but what if I summon it here? Can he go anywhere from there? Alright, I guess not. We have to open this. And he died.
I'm ready.
If only I could use Rhin in this task as well, that would be nice. Let's try with the human figure again. Let's see, maybe this time. Yes! Fuck yes! And let's see who is in this chamber. It's a status chamber of some sort. There are no controls on it anywhere. Nothing that could help you raise the floors to reach the depths of the labyrinth. A woman lies inside, clearly visible through the shimmering energy field and looking as though she were asleep. Her features are exactly those of the ghostly woman who met you in the calm. You mean that ghost woman? Well, anyway, something disturbs the air next to you. The ghostly woman's face begins to appear, as though your thoughts summoned her. You did summon me, she says, intuiting your thoughts. I can discern your memories more clearly than the others, even more clearly than your own, than my own. She looks sadly down into the chamber. But I remember now. This is who I was, the daughter of the changing god. What? So you are the daughter of the changing god? It was long ago, after the Tapaht had laid siege to Sakus Cliffs. My father fought them off, and I was among the survivors, but I didn't exactly survive. One of the Tapaht's weapons made me sick somehow, in my mind. He discovered how to transfer consciousness, my consciousness, into a new body, hoping it would save me, but it didn't. She places a hand on the surface of the chamber. My sickness followed me, in my mind, so my father put me in there. He tried to find a cure for me, and when that failed, he tried to bring me back from death itself. He thought I was consciousness in there, but I remember. The memories are fragmented, but they are there. I was aware of everything, and with so many new memories flooding my mind, I'm able to fill in the gasps I didn't know. Does this mean you're a castoff, then? Her eyebrows strut together, then she shakes her head. I don't think so. I had my own consciousness like my father does. This is who I was. Now I'm probably just a memory, stored forever in the labyrinth. How often has he tried to bring you back? Considering he had centuries to do it, not very often. A lot at first, then only when he remembered or had some new idea. He used the probability engines underneath Sakus Cliffs to birth women with my personality. He tried to use Heaven's rejoinden. His means for turning back defeats in the endless battle. Once he tried to kidnap a version of me from an alternate reality, but she died in a tragic accident. He never tried that again. Interesting. Kidnapping people from alternate realities. That sounds so freaking interesting. How much do you remember from being in that tank? I can't tell you in time measurements. I only know I was in the tank until the sorrow attacked us. My father fled, saving himself. She laughs once, but there's no humor in it. Maybe he figured he could bring me back even without my body. It's the kind of thing he would assume. Her face darkens. Or maybe he didn't care. Well, he has become kind of full. Has become kind of full of himself. Does that mean this phantom is constructed from your memories? She looks around her, taking it all in for the first time. I don't recognize. No, wait. Yes, it's all twisted and disordered, like in a nightmare. But yes, I think these are my memories. I need to get to that portal. Can you build me a path?
Yeah. I'm ready to learn something new.
She looks you directly in the eye, strong and certain. Yes, I can. Thanks. If only I was smart enough to summon you earlier. Go, she says. Stop him. He's harmed more lives than anyone can count. If you have the power to heal the floors, would you have the power to heal me as well? Well, might as well. While you are in this place? Yes, I think I might. You feel nothing more than a tingle as she places her hand on your shoulder. Then an immense weight of tranquility fills your body and mind. Nice.
I can breathe again.
And I also can go to level. Let's see. Let's see what ability I could. I don't really like any of these, really. A skill. And I don't really see anything that I really want from here either. Maybe running could be kind of useful, since I'm kind of melee character right now. So that would be nice. But then again, I have the teleportation ability, so I don't think I necessarily need it. And I don't need this one either right now. I think I just increase stat pools. I'm gonna give all points to might. Yeah, I like that. Error. There must be some sort of a bug there. Do not dally here. He must be stopped. Yeah, but... Alright, let's go. I just wanted to check if you had anything new to say before we go. So, let's go and confront our sire. This feels so final in a way. Final in a sense that it feels like we are very close to finish and end this game. And I've only played this for like... What? Last time I checked on Steam, it was 32, maybe now 33 hours. I've only played this game for like 33 hours now. That's what I tried to say.
Now.
It cannot be this short. And I have done like most of the side quests I have found. So, anything interesting here besides these doors? No.
All right.
And we can't get to that big door just yet. We have to do something with this. Wait, isn't this the same place where we were and in the very first episode when we created our character? Yeah, it at least looks very similar. Countless scratches and wounds mar the surface of this door. Someone made a great effort to get inside, but to no avail. As you approach, however, the bars of the door shudder and bend. It wants to let you in. Well, let's go in there. The door doesn't open at your touch. Instead, you are drawn into the door itself. Alright. One of these things. You are in a glass dome, several kilometers above the ground. Blue sky fills your vision. Beneath you is a floor of golden metal. A defeating klaxon blares in warning against something. A familiar looking stasis chamber lies in the center of the dome. A chest fashioned from synth and cold iron sits to one side. Behind the pod, a diamond hovers in the air, scattering prismatic light. A pedestal glows near your hand, a deep azure blue. There's nothing that seems to warrant the blaring klaxons, yet you know the alarm sounds for a reason. Look at the chamber. It's a ghostly woman's stasis chamber, the real one from which the labyrinth construction were made. The changing guard's daughter lies inside. Her skin is pale and there are dark circles around her eyes. Her chest rises and falls as though she were sleeping soundly. The laboratory, this body, must belong to the changing guard. Mm-hmm. Investigate the hovering diamond. As soon as you approach the diamond, the top of it blooms open. An illusionary globe appears within. Words and images beat across its surface. A woman's voice speaks directly into your mind. Welcome back. Please state your query. A wave of familiarity slams into you. The changing guard used this as an archival device. He kept records of his thoughts and experiments. Specific records can be retrieved by speaking a search term. Alarm. The illusionary globe becomes blank. The voice speaks into your mind. There are no matching entries. Please state your query. The tides. Previews of several entries flit through your mind. There are scores of results you can't figure out how they are organized, nor how to quickly ascertain whether an entry will be useful to you or not. It takes some time to shift through them for something useful. You will have to be careful what you spend time researching. Finally, you find one that's what you're looking for. What were we looking for? A male voice, the voice of the body you are wearing, speaks in your mind. Your voice says, "The tides have proven to be an extremely fruitful path of exploration." Oh yeah, the tides, of course. "The Tapath don't realize what they have unearthed. They saw these trinkets as just more Numenera. But these forces may even have the power to turn back death itself. I certainly hope so, for her sake." The changing guard. The illusionary globe becomes blank. The voice speaks into your mind. There are no matching entries. Please state your query. Daughter. Same thing. Did a path. Your voice says, "Did a path were fools, but they were skilled scavengers, gifted with the luck of having discovered the underspine. I still don't know what the underspine is, but I'm convinced it came from the Dalad. The same people from which I gleaned the powers of the tides and figured out the key to consciousness transfer. It's the best explanation for the Tapath's success. Without the underspine, they are little more than abhumans of above average intelligence." Holy crap! There is a thunderous boom. The floor shakes and sways beneath you, causing you to lose your balance. Outside the dome, the horizon tilts back and forth, giving you a sense of vertigo. Suddenly, a man appears in front of you. He's not all there. You can see the clouds and vista on the other side of him. He wears a look of human terror on its face. "It's broken into the tower. It's only a matter of time before it reaches us here. We have to do something fast." His mannerisms remind you of the specter from the labyrinth, though his face, clothes, and a voice are not the same. "What's here? Why are the alarms going off?" His face darkens. "The sorrow is here. It found us somehow, and now it's trying to break into the lab. We need to get out of here." Yeah, it's a sorrow. Why is the sorrow here? What does it want? Well, I think I'm quite sure. I'm sure we all know what it wants. It wants to freaking kill us. Return your attention to the stasis chamber. Outside the glass dome, the horizon moves slightly as though the entire laboratory were swaying several kilometers up in the air. In the middle of the room is a large chamber with a figure inside of it. Maybe should we open it and pick her up and get the hell out of here? Open the chamber. The spectral man appears between you and the chamber. His hands are raised in front of him placidly. "Hey, what are you doing? If you open that, Mika will die." Ah, so her name is Mika. Right. "What should we do?" "I strongly advise you to save yourself, thus saving both of our minds. Unfortunately, that would mean leaving her." He looks at the chamber and frowns. "I don't like it any more than you do. The only other options I can think of are to somehow stop the sorrow by force. Unlikely. Or figure out what it wants. He shakes his transcendent head. I don't think we have enough time for either. But maybe you know something I don't. He points to the hovering diamond. Maybe you can find something in your archives to help us. Just be careful what you research in there. We don't have any time to waste. Alright. Well, I guess we go back to the archive. Welcome back. Welcome back. Please state your inquiry. Escape. Your voice says, I won't take any risks with this new body. I have initiated a fail-safe procedure to transport me away should something happen to me or the laboratory. If any unforeseen danger presents itself, I should be able to escape to a backup location. The sorrow. The voice says, I don't know what the sorrow is exactly. Just that it's old. Really old. And it doesn't pay much attention to established laws of space-time. I wonder just how established those laws really are. Anyway, I first came across mention of it in my research of the tides. It appears to have been some kind of guardian against tidal abuse. Evidence suggests it may have been solely responsible for the destruction of one of the prior worlds. The voice signs. My experiments with consciousness transfer appear to have awoken it. I don't believe it's after me specifically, but I have come to believe it was responsible for the destruction of my previous laboratory. Suddenly there is a tremendous popping sound. The air sifts, causing every hair to stand on end and your entire body to tingle dangerously. The spectral man appears in front of you again. It puts its hands on your shoulders, though you feel nothing. It shattered the electrostatic shield. If it breaks through the plasma window, we are done for. It looks at the hatch in the ground as though it could see through it. What's your plan? You have got a plan, right? Well, not really, no. How close is the sorrow? Well, it's very close. Archive diamond. Let's see what else we can do. Mika. Your voice says, Mika's condition has not improved after the consciousness transfer. If anything, it was worsened. I have traced the cause to the weapon I retrieved from the Tabath after their failed siege of Sakus Cliffs, but damned if I know how to undo its effects. There's an agonized pause. I don't understand. I should be able to figure this out. I will figure it out. I just need more data. I have discovered a theoretical process to merge my consciousness with hers, but I just need more data. With luck, I can run experiments in the next few days. Dalad. Unlock the other entries. This one is not in your voice, but the female voice that belongs to the archival diamond itself. The Dalad people are believed to have existed long before the Ninth World. Dalad is probably not what they call themselves. Their true name is unknown. They made great use of a force referred to in these archives as the Tides, using them especially to affect individual psyches. The civilization of the Dalad did not decline, but was completely wiped out by a creature called the Sorrow. So the Sorrow must have destroyed the Dalad because of how they abused the Tides. If the weapon that caused Mika's illness was from this same civilization, then it stands to reason her illness is tidal in nature. Like a tidal surge, perhaps. If so, maybe there's some way you can undo it. The spectral advisor might know more. Oh shit, Cthulhu is here. There's a hiss and screech beneath the floor. Suddenly, the metal hatch flies off its hinges, cracking the strongless ceiling, then smashing the glowing pedestal. The spectral man's image disappears. A foul black cloud rises from the hatch, and the air is filled with an unearthly wail and the stench of rotten flesh. Tentacles lash out, slicing metal and sin wherever they touch it. A terrible face emerges from the cloud. It examines you, then it turns its attention to the chamber. Leave her alone. I'm the one who initiated the consciousness transfer. Take me. Attack the sorrow. Call out the advisor. Get me out of here. Leave her alone. I'm the one who initiated the consciousness transfer. Take me. The sorrow turns its horrible attention to you. One of its tendrils darts toward you, slicing through both the strong glass wall and steel floor. It reaches your face and you feel nothing. The tendril goes right through your body. You realize that the dome is fading away. No, your body is fading away as some device tucks it safely away to another location. The Sorrow's unearthly wail becomes a shriek. Though the spectral advisor is gone, you hear his voice in your head. Thank goodness the failsafe kicked in. You'll be safe, though the girl and I are doomed. I'll be easy to recover, but she... I'm sure you'll... He's cut off as the Sorrow's tendrils flay the laboratory all around in it in a blind fury. The chest and diamond are cut to ribbons. The chamber disintegrates in a ball of purple flame. And the last thing you see as your mind fades from this body is the face of the young girl, melting and boiling into ash. Jesus Christ. Oh, Jesus freaking Christ. Ah, it's Mika. Oh wait, is that her? It must be her. The ghostly woman appears next to you. She stares at the door you just emerged from, her eyes as round as the moon. I remember now. All of it. I told you I was aware of everything while I was in that chamber. I remember my father abandoning me. I remember too how you risked your life for me. After the Sorrow destroyed the change's stasis chamber, I woke up here, in the labyrinth. I wasn't aware though. Not for a long time. Not until you came and started changing things. What do you mean I started changing things? She looks at you. Her eyes are brighter now, full of confidence. You are the last castoff. The one my father created to witness this place, to command it. You have been changing the labyrinth since you were first born. You are the one who will decide our fate. So you are not just a memory. No, she says, firm and certain. I am not a memory, nor a reflection, nor a lacuna. I am Mika, the full consciousness of the changing god's daughter. But I couldn't save you, though. You tried, which is more than I can say for my father. You risked your own life, she sighs deeply. Besides, if you had died in there, you and every other castle would never have existed. Maybe there are some realities you can't change. I understand all that I need to. So what do we do now? She points to the door on the opposite side of the fathom. There is one more mirror. Enter it. Open the resonance and end this for all of us. Go, there's not much time. This really sounds very... And... Did I get another level? Holy shit, I actually did. Jesus Christ. Maybe I should... Let's get some extra effort. But like I was saying, this feels so final. This game can't end here. Not in this episode anyway. But let's see. The light around the door's frame dims and flares like a roaring fire in a high wind. As you approach, the bars of the door shudder and bend. It wants to let you in. So basically the same thing. What do we have here? Oh Christ, now this looks very alien. A world revolves far below you, a sunset in scarlet flaring on the horizon. To the east, deep indigo shadows fall, painting the planet with darkness. The faintest shimmer of a forest green distorts your vision, and the exhalation of the station pushes warm, moist air across your skin. With a shock, you realize that the view before you is almost identical to the world you saw as you fell to the earth, just slightly higher. You hold an intricately filigreed metal staff. Its carvings slither under your fingers as if it were alive. You are in a great hall that is more like an organic space than a constructed room. Machinery literally sprouts from the floors and walls, with no signs of where the synthetic metal gives way to the substrata from which it has grown. Though humid, the hall feels clean and fresh, healthy and vibrant, full of promise. A holographic map of the moon hovers at the back wall, near a small glowing pot. A voice speaks, as if from the air itself. Are you certain this procedure will give you final control over the castoffs? If you're mistaken, the chamber may fail, or worse, detonate with you inside. The voice is familiar, but you can't quite put your finger on its identity. What are you talking about? You had me run the calculations, remember? I told you that there was a slight chance it might explode with you inside, though the chances were vanishingly slim, and come on, it was only the other day, I realize you have a lot on your mind right now, but we need to focus. We have been trying to get this right for years, centuries. The resonant chamber is ready in Sakus. We just need to make sure this body will work as a catalyst. So, are they working on my body right now? If something happens down there, I'll signal you to move to the next vessel. And if you don't get out in time, well, you have got me. Let's hear it for redundancy. For now, just settle into the pot and we'll make sure this body will work for us. You have pinpointed the source of the voice. It's coming from the staff in your hands. You peer at it more closely and you see a glowing ghostly image, the holographic advisor from the other mirror. No, this advisor looks different. Augmented. It has the ghostly blue-limbed smoky appearance of the Spectre. It is the Spectre. I know you. Remember how the process works? I don't want any part of this. I've been trying to stop this from happening. Don't remember how the staff works. You study the staff and it feels like coming home. It is a familiar friend, a comforting ally. It is a cornerstone to this moon. A key to every lock. You know that it copies your mind weakly, serving as a failsafe and a familiar, a consciousness that is your natural ally. When it speaks with the Spectre's voice, and when it must manifest, it can create a ghostly image of the changing god's original body. Holding it, you feel safe, in control. Remind me how the process works. We are going to run the final assessment on this body. Complete scans, review, title adjustment if necessary. We will verify that all of the parameters are within tolerance. Settle into the pot and I'll take care of the rest. I don't want any part of this. I've been trying to stop this from happening. Well, I don't even actually know what is exactly going on here. I assume that this is a changing god in the last castoff's body, our body. And he's about to enter to the pot and go and drop down to the earth, to Sakus Cliffs, where a resonant chamber is. I assume that's the case, but I could be wrong. Should we just go to the pot and do how things really happened, or? Well, fuck it, let's go. You glance around the Great Hall one last time. Your gaze lingering on the map of the station, and walk to a small chamber near a vast hallway. A deactivated construct stands nearby in a state of partial disassembly. Its hand thrust out as if in offering. Near the large control panel outside, a column of spongy scarlet discs hover silently, reminding you of nothing so much as giant blood patelets or conchealing scabs. You take a deep breath and step into the pot. The staff in your hand vibrates slightly and you feel yourself bathed in energies. Remain calm, this is all well within normal parameters. The minor explosion that follows surely is not sudden clacker's flare. It's the sorrow again, isn't it? The nearby platelets vibrate furiously and the deactivated construct's arm begins to spark and flare. Get out! The sorrow is going to destroy you! Yes, of course it's the freaking sorrow. Your nemesis manifests in the Great Hall, its form in a tenuous wispy as it conceals. It gains solidity in fits and starts. The moon's internal defenses are slowing it, but they will not be enough to keep it out. As you watch, the sorrow shrugs itself past another line of defenses, jerking itself forward a more terrible reality. Its focus snaps toward you. It coils and writhes, desperate to wipe you from existence. Get to another pot. We can always make a new catalyst. Go. How do I flee this body? Do you have anything that can stop the sorrow? Anamnesis perception. Study the map to find the way to escape the pots. quick fingers and lore. Natural, try to pull off one of the vibrating parallels. Examine the construct. The construct itself is beyond repair, but a quick study reveals that each of the construct's limbs were designed for independent power. So even though most of the construct is quiescent, its spiked, powered hand is not. Working quickly, you detach it from the construct's frame. It will be a suitable gauntlet. The powers that course through it might serve to delay the sorrow's advance. Try to pull off one of the vibrating pallets. Well, might as well try. You take hold of one of the discs. Your fingers sink into the spongy material, and with a slight twist of your wrist, you detach it from the column of energy that holds it. It hums and cycles in a pitch that makes your eyes shudder. With each cycle, the disc shifts your vision, changing the colors you perceive. The tides churn within as you hold it. It may have some effect on the sorrow. Anamnesics perception. Study the map to find a way to escape the pods. It's a multi-level projection. Its orientation and layout is prepared in a way that is naturally pleasing to your eye, and you trace the route to a nearby escape cocoon without difficulty. You have to remember the layout of the halls, but the map is clear enough that you think you can remember the route. You feel the moon shudder, then you feel it tear. The alarms in the great hall have begun to strobe. The lights flicker. The moon's moist air suddenly shrieks past you. The sorrow has breached its walls. God damn it. The hallway branches, with countless offshoots piercing the winding passages of the moon. You know that your escape lies down one of these routes. Your study of the map puts you in good stead here. You count down the passages, and every landmark that you expect arrives when you expect it. As you race through the halls, you see a small slot in the wall. It holds a firm green gel that you know contains some kind of memory. Try to figure out how the green memory gel works. Well, fuck it. You press your forehead to the gel. It soaks into your skin, leaving behind a dry viridian paste. You are constructing the staff you hold. The specter speaks over your shoulder. This is strange, isn't it? Knowing that I'm watching you make my home, that I'm going to be updated in a week with your experiences, that my consciousness will fill this room, and thus so will you, in an unbroken indefinite chain. You say, I don't hold any illusions about the sanctity of consciousness, but then you know that already. He laughs aloud. This conversation is turning us into a solipsist. You smile. We have been called worse. The memory fades. Keep running. Get to the escape pods. You pound into the bay, the door shutting behind you. Your breath comes hot in your chest. You double over to catch your breath. Several cocoons are arranged along the outer wall. You'll need to activate one, and it will spin its webbing around you. The smart membrane is tough, heat-resistant, and it will transfer the entirety of the genetic force away from you at the moment of impact. You see an injection of some sort, but it's across the bay. You might not have time to reach it. The sorrow tears apart the wall in a fury of light and tidal energy. The flickering energies inside its hood betray no emotion except hunger. It is inexorable. The most you can hope to do is slow it. Use the pallet you tore from the column of energy to slow the sorrow. You heard the platelet across the bay. The instant it leaves your fingers, it begins to change its shape. It becomes a cloth, a shroud, and it curls over the sorrow, enveloping your enemy. It molts itself across the creature like a giant scab, fixing the sorrow in place. For a moment, you dare hope that you have arrested its motion. But the scapular's fabric cracks, peels, and falls to the floor in a pile of organic flakes. You only have one defense left. You hardly trust it will be enough to get you to the cocoons and off this doomed moon. Better to run straight for the only hope of escape. Climb into the escape pod. You slip into the cocoon, activate the ejection sequence, and trigger it. The membrane embraces you, forcing you to drop the staff. Forcing you to drop the staff, and begins to slide free of the killing crown of the moon. And then your tattoo blazes, as if it's tearing open, an onslaught of the tides, all in blue and silver, a stream of information too fast and too large to process. A mighty blast buffets the cocoon, and you feel one of the sorrow's inky tendrils caress your cheek and burn into your mind, searing away knowledge and memory even as you tumble toward the earth. Amidst unspeakable pain, you feel something new forming within you, but you lose consciousness before you can identify what it is. Alright, so that was that. Now can we finally get there? There we go. The Spectre. I had hoped you would open that for me, and here we are, the Spectre says, and his voice is not tied to his body. It pours from the walls around you, from the shifting floor beneath your feet. It's time for some hard truth, child. Before he can finish, the air twists in the room. An explosion of light and scarlet figure steps out of it. Oh shit, it's the Sorrow, isn't it? Oh, wait, no. It's the First. How's this for truth? Her voice is worn and hard behind her mask. The resonance is mine. It belongs to me and all castoffs. I have worked too hard for it to be otherwise. Stand aside, old man, and let us determine our own destiny. His smile is disconcerting. Your destiny? You are a part of me. Your destiny was never yours to determine, and the resonance is not yours to claim. He gestures a hand in your direction. Only the latest castoff can open the door. That body and I are the only ones capable of using the power beyond. You are out of your depth, Marorel, and this no longer concerns you. He ignores her and turns to you. I needed you to open the door, and you have done that. The cage, I can handle on my own. His voice presses down on you like a hand, as if trying to drop you to your knees. When I enter the resonance, it will be to return my errant children to my mind where they belong. Leave me to it, and we have no further quarrel. What do you say? You would think someone who calls himself a changing god would learn from his mistakes. I'm thinking about it. This hasn't been an easy road. I'll die before I let you in there. Yeah, I like this one. You would think someone who calls himself a changing god would learn from his mistakes. Irritation flashes across his transculent face. I'm not here to debate who I am or what I have done. I'm here to claim what's mine. The ground rumbles menacingly beneath your feet. And what is that, exactly? He looks at the ghostly form of the changing god's daughter as if noticing her for the first time. His surprise is a brief, chill wind whipping across the darkness between you. You, he mutters. You are her ghost, the one that haunts me. My daughter is dead, do you hear me? I can't bring her back, no matter how hard I try. Is that so? But she apparently has nothing more to say to him. He shakes his head. Enough. I don't wish to fight you, castoff, but neither will you keep me from this. What will it be? You are right, you have earned this. No, screw that. She is your daughter. She told me so. The resonant chamber is not yours to claim. The real changing god died when I was born. You are just a backup of his memories. What? So he is basically a clone of his own consciousness. Well, that's okay. Weird. The resonant chamber is not yours to claim. The real changing god died when I was born. You are just a backup of his memories. You speak in simple terms, the Spectre says, arcing an eyebrow. But you are dense, even for one of my castoffs. I am the changing god, and you are standing in my way. Ah, Rhin says something too. If you were truly this changing god, then this woman, she points to the changing god's daughter, even if this woman were just a memory, she should recognize you as her father, don't you think? Rhin looks kindly on the ghostly woman, then back at the Spectre. But I saw it. I saw it on her face when you challenged her. You are a stranger to her. He flinches and turns to face her. She meets his eyes, blinking once, and shakes her head. You are not her, he says. Then with more force, he repeats himself. You are not her! Of course you don't know me. He turns his head from her entirely, staring into the dark. He growls under his breath. I remember speaking to you on the moon. You are not the changing god. You are an assistant, an update. Consciousness needs to be continuous. You're a copy of what the changing god was. If there's any heir to the mantle of the changing god, it's me. I've been able to change the past throughout the mirrors ever since I awoke. You need me in ways the changing god wouldn't. You could not activate the resonant chamber without me. Nor even open this door. Be honest, don't you have any doubts? The changing god wouldn't have lost when we fought. When did we fight? I don't remember. Attack, you will not enter that room. I will make sure of it. I think I like this one better. I remember speaking to you on the moon. You are not the changing god. You are an assistant, an update. He says slowly. And I said the conversation was turning us into a solipsist. And we said we have been called worse. His voice sharpens. But we also said that we hold no illusions about the sanctity of consciousness. That remains true. He signs. Consciousness needs to be continuous. If there's any heir to the mantle of changing god, it's me. Well, let's go with this one. And by that reason, anyone who's had a dreamless, drunken night is also a copy of the previous selves. The specter says without pausing for thought. Spare me your philosophy, castoff. If there's any heir to the mantle of the changing god, it's me. I've been able to change the passed through the mirrors ever since I awoke. This sounds a bit too ambitious for my character, really. You need me in ways the changing god wouldn't. You could not activate the resonant chamber without me, not even open this door. You oversimplify. The accident made me a prisoner here, and now, a short time later, I have control here, in the very root of your mind. But there is nothing new in his eyes now. But there is something new in his eyes now. Fear. Enough of this, he mutters, but there is no anger in his voice anymore. No fire, only a great weariness. You are right. At first, I convinced myself I wasn't whole anymore. That something had broken in me, or been left behind. He stares at his hand, or through it. But it makes sense. I'm not him. I'm close. As close as anyone, but the changing god is dead. He leans his hand fall. Bit by bit, he begins fading away. Okay. You did it. He's gone. She sparks a short laugh. You have accomplished something I could never achieve. I suppose I owe you my gratitude.
Hey, it looks like you've got this, and I...
She looks anxiously over her shoulder, as though someone had called her name.
Mm-hmm. I can't stay. I'm sorry.
No!
I can't. I'm glad I got to see you one more time, though.
No, don't go. You are like the most best fucking party member I've ever had in this entire game so far. Plus, I like you. Please don't go. Why can't you stay? Huh? I wasn't just sitting around waiting to rescue you. You know, I was actually in the middle of something. She adjusts her back and glances over her shoulder again. Anyway, this is your world, not mine. You know that. Will we ever meet again? She bites her lip. I hope so. Keep Tehria on you. Maybe if you need me. Well, he called me once, didn't he? She glances behind her again. Even if he doesn't, you will always be with me. I wouldn't be who I am without you. Suddenly she launches forward and throws her arms around you. It's amazing how tall she is. Taller than you. Yes, I noticed. She kisses you on the cheek. When she pulls back and smiles, her tears are barely noticeable.
Farewell, my friend. My home and hearth and bread are forever yours.
Aww, don't go, please. A portal opens suddenly. The bright light and trees you remember from before spill out of it. She waves one last time and turns to step through it. Oh, not again. Game, you're so cruel. You're so cruel, game, you know that? First you make me to let her go back home. Then you give her back to me as a big, tall, badass with great stats and great abilities, and cool, fucking cool abilities and all that. And then you just take her away from me again. God damn it, game. And I got a level again. Holy shit! I think I have got three levels in this one episode so far. Hmm. I guess I should just increase edge. Fuck it, let's just go with might. Alright. Well, before we go anywhere, let's have a little chat with these people and see what they have to say. Well, are you going to open it, or do I have to kill you and open it myself? You won. Now do what you came to do. Well, let's go. Pulsing waves of heat roll down the stairs, and you hear a low, continuous whirring that's somewhere between a sigh and a melody. The door is singing, as though welcoming you back. Even in this low light, the wheel at the bottom of the door fairly glows. You feel your palms tingle at the sight of it. Something clicks in your mind, and the door answers. Hitting gear spin behind the cage. The door is opening for you and you alone. This feels so final. Oh shit, I don't like that. I'm gonna have to fight this sorrow. Rhin, why did you have to leave me now? Oh fuck. The sorrow is here in its full power, wearing the unquiet psyches of its victims like a tattered cloak. Filaments of light and energy leak from it, strange colors that correspond to no tides you know. Its tentacles flutter and flap in an unseen breeze. You come before me at last, yet we have met so many times before. Its voice is a hissing multitude. One voice stands atop the rest, a woman's voice, soft and deep. It gives me no pleasure to meet you in this place, but you and your kind have left me no choice. Everybody your sire creates abuses those forces you call the tides. They draw energy from those around them. In doing so, you weaken the seals on energy you do not comprehend. You increase the amount of suffering in the world. Every attempt at mitigating the damage has failed. Every step results in misery. You are the first in millennia to hear me speak in an embodied language. You are persistent, tenacious, and durable. And so perhaps words will suffice where destruction has failed. It is time to bring this experiment in immortality to a close. How have the tides increased suffering in the world? The tides themselves do not cause suffering, rather the abuse of them in your bodies. Your kind has wrought torment on the world in the name of endless life. You bring pain, large and small, deliberate and inadvertent. Without you, the endless battle would never have raged. Without you, the children of the endless gate would not have terrorized the world. Betrayals, slaughter, and bloodshed are the hallmarks of a castoff's wake. Well, I don't know. I'm quite sure that betrayals, slaughter, and bloodshed would happen regardless, even if we did not exist, because that's the human nature. The sorrow is silent for a moment. Then, your sister, the slaver Tolmagur, cast her suffering into the child, Rhin. Though the girl had done her no harm. Your sister Matkina took her adoptive father's eyes, and though she mourned, she did not change her ways. Even the saintly Ardiris brought torment into this world. She thought she drew my attention when she lashed out at me in Mil Avest. No, she was already marked in her body. Your sire broke the jagged dream to Sakus Cliffs. To form its strife. Ardiris rejected them, but chaos and misery trailed even in her passage through the world. Castoffs bring pain. How has our existence caused suffering again? Alright, then let's end this. I'm just trying to stop the abuse of the tides. Are you? We shall see. I know what they say of me. Destroyer of civilizations. Death's mistress. Soul taker. Ender of the cycle and circle. Yet I take no pleasure in destruction. My pursuit of your kind has been solely a matter of expedience. But you have come this far, despite my attempts to stop you. I will give you a last chance at an alternate solution. When Ardiris asked you what one life matters, you replied that each life is important. A world of potential. We shall see if you will stand by those words. Oh, alright. So here comes once again comes the main and question of this game. What does one life matter? This feels very... This feels like the end of the game, really. What is this place? Why are you here? What are you? I convinced the Spectre that the true changing god is dead. Is this true? I don't know. I thought we knew it was true. Adiris said she never used a tidal surgery in her life. How did she abuse the tides? Well, I guess we can just ask all this. This place is the central chamber of your collective mind space. It is the resonance, the true expression of which your resonant chamber was but a shadow. In this place, you touch the knowledge and strength of every castoff ever created. Why are you here? When you escaped me on the moon, I placed a piece of myself here as a last resort. I have written here in your mind since then. Indeed, I could not have found the moon had you not returned to it in the mirror, bringing me along with you. I called myself to myself in that reality, breaching the station's defenses to close the loop of time that brought me here, all to ensure that the power of the resonance is not abused, that your kind does not worsen the world again. And what are you exactly? I am a guardian, a protector, a legacy of a forgotten people, tasked to watch over that which they fail to defend. I convinced the Spectre that the true changing god is dead. Is this true? It is late to speak of truths and identities. The one you called the Spectre was the embodiment of the changing god's life and memories. When you convinced him he was dead, that became true enough. All that remains of the changing god, all that he is and was, is here, now in the labyrinth. Adiris said she never used a tidal surge in her life. How did she abuse the tides? The surges are one manifestation of that suffering, but your kind draw and distort the energy of the tides at a level you cannot understand. Her passage left lovers quibbling, children crying, and conflicts escalated that might have been avoided. Though she suspected this true and sought the shelter of Miel Avest, even she has been the author of invisible miseries. Every one of you is the same. Right. And so what happens now? It is up to you. The question is, with what purpose have you come? I came here to stop you from hunting us. Yeah. I came here to stop the tidal abuse caused by our bodies. Yeah, that too. I came here to keep the changing god from snuffing out our existence. That sounds a bit too selfish, and I don't want to piss her off. Oh, I never meant to come here. I came here to end the tidal abuse caused by our bodies. If you speak truly, then our purpose are as one. My sire believed that subsuming all the castoffs into himself would stop you from hunting us. Is that true? The first castoff said that severing the connection between us would stop you from hunting us. Is that true? What if I just want everything back the way it was? The way it was. Not sure what we are referring to here exactly. Can we ask both of these? Well, let's ask this one. The first said that severing the connection between us would stop you from hunting us. Is that true? The connection of which he speaks is the labyrinth itself. You would no longer draw your power from this place, and my pursuit of your world keys. Your sister's solution would have shattered this place. It would have destroyed the tidal seals that protect the populace from madness. My charter is to guard those seals, to protect that energy. Had her plan actually worked, it would have destroyed the minds of thousands. I could not allow that to occur. My sire believed that subsuming all the castoffs into himself would stop you from hunting us. Is that true? It sounds almost thoughtful. Perhaps, for a time, if he could resist making no further castoffs. But I have trailed him across the centuries and I know that he could not resist. The lure of new experience is too strong for him to resist. He would awaken me again and again. What if the castoffs were subsumed into someone else? Someone who wouldn't perpetuate the cycle? Could you find such a person? I would consider it an ideal solution. Yet consider this space. The Sorrow's arms sweep across the resonance, strangely aflutter, their movement bending your perceptions. This is a space too large for any mortal mind. Even one fracture turned through reality cannot hold it all. Only someone already attuned to the labyrinth might successfully contain your mind. Only one of your kind. You said someone attuned to the labyrinth could contain the minds of the castoffs. Does that include Mika? Interesting. Tell me who can contain the consciousness of all castoffs again. Is there another way to sever the tidal connection? What if I just let's ask this. This is more interesting. She has no body, but if you were to allow her to rise to the surface of your mind, to take your body, then it would be possible for her to absorb these experiences. Though I do not know if it would cure the illness that spawned her father's experiments. Is there another way to sever the tidal connection? And another thing that I would like to ask, if we really cut our connection to the ties, wouldn't that kill us? The resonant chamber was a blunt instrument. Alone, it would have shattered and destroyed the labyrinth. The resonance, however, is a sharp edge. It can sever the connection cleanly and without harm, eliminating your kind and the threat you pose to the integrity of the tidal energies. It is the wise choice, but it would eliminate my kind and kill us. Now, what if I just want everything back the way it was? Is that possible? It considers your words, teasing out the ramification. At last it speaks. Yes, you and your kind can continue to exist, and I will continue to hunt you down, the ever-present looming specter of your mortality, erasing you from history one by one. So wait, yes, you and your kind can continue to exist, and I will continue to hunt you down, the ever-present looming specter of your mortality, erasing you from history one by one. I will allow this, although I don't really like that idea. It seems like you allow my choice I make. What will you oppose? Tell me who can contain again. It seems like you allow any choice I make. What will you oppose? It hesitates, as if not sure it should impart this information. The resonance has the power to combine and sever, and to remove the protections of the tides entirely. Doing so will unfetter a truly dangerous force imperiling the land and the psychic landscape for millennia. I cannot permit this choice and will resist it with all my strength. Remove the protections? Protections like you? I am part of those protections, but not the only part. The released tidal force would flow across this territory, devastating the mental landscape. Many would suffer serious damage to their sanity, and others would find travel to the resilient psychic pollution impossible for thousands of years. It draws itself into a more sinister form. This I will not allow. Well, I guess it's better that we don't try that then. Well, how do I choose? I have entwined myself through every piece of this place. It is mine. Tell me your choice and I will make it reality. If I approve. If you would prefer that we all die, why don't you just sever the connection? I have manifested here, but I do not control the resonance itself. I am the lock on the door, while your thoughts are the key. Your will remains paramount in this place. I can resist your choice, but I cannot make the choice for you. And what if you don't approve my choice? Then I will oppose you with all my strength. That is why I'm here. I think I need to ask some of these questions again. Tell me, who can contain the consciousness of all castoffs again? Only one who is attuned to the resonance. Only one who is here. Tell me again, what would happen if we severed the connection between castoffs? You and your kind would die. Yeah, just like the other castoff, Emil Avest said, requiring no intervention from me. It would be a choice you made to eliminate the danger you pose, once and for all. but we would die. But I don't like that. I want to live. I can really set everything back the way it was when I was born. You will remain my prey. It is not an ideal solution, but it is not one that I will oppose. Very well, I'm ready to make my choice. Well, not really, I need to think about this some more. Well, there's more options. It ripples in the mental breeze that flows from your confidence. I await your decision. I'll finish the changing god's work and merge all the castoffs into my own consciousness. But at the same time, it would kinda kill every castoff, I guess. We castoffs are a cancer. I will sever the tidal connection to excise our influence on the world. So basically we would sacrifice ourselves. Something tells me that the first castoff would not be a huge fan of that idea. None of its choices are right, and I have no right to choose the fate of so many. I want to return everything and everyone the way it was. So we have no right to choose the fate, and yet we would still choose the option to go back in time, basically. I want to return everything and everyone the way it was. The only one blameless in all of this is Mika, the mortal daughter of the changing god. Merge our consciousness into her, and she'll live out her days in my body. This is perhaps the ethically most right solution so far. My eldest sister, the first, I choose her as the repository of our minds. I reject your authority, Sorrow. I will use the resonance to destroy you, and all of us will live free. Or we can just say screw you and then destroy the Sorrow. Or at least I hope we could destroy the Sorrow if we really wanted to try. I want to ask some questions first. As you wish, time is immaterial. I don't seem to be able to ask whether I can destroy you. And what would happen after that. I would like to make my choice. Alright, I cannot ask anything like that. The only one blameless in all of this is Mika, the mortal daughter of the changing god. Merge our consciousness into her, and she'll live out her days in my body. I reject your authority, Sorrow. I will use the resonant chamber to destroy you, and all of us will live free. I like both of these. 4 and 6. So if I understood correctly, if we all merge to one and basically give the controls to Mika, she would live again in using our body, and all the minds of the castoffs would be in this labyrinth. But we would not be alive anymore per se. We would all just be memories and reflections here in the labyrinth. That's how I understand it anyway. Or we can try to fight the Sorrow and continue living. But then again, if we continued living, we would still continue bringing death, misery, sorrow, betrayal, and all that shit in the world. But then again, humans are kind of doing that already. I mean, it's the human nature, so it's not like the Sorrow can blame everything on us. God damn it, this is a hard choice. What would my character do? That is the question. What would my character do? I've been playing most. I can't go to inventory here, or can I? Character abilities. No, what is this? Alright. But my character has been pretty altruistic so far. We are mostly tied to the golden tide, which is about compassion, altruism and all that stuff, if I remember correctly. So, with that in mind, I guess that 4 would possibly make more sense, while the 6th option would be a bit more selfish. I mean, sure, we would all the castoffs besides us would live freely, but we would cause more cause more misery to other people around us. So I guess 4 option would make sense. The only one blameless in all of this is Mika, the mortal daughter of the changing god. Merge our consciousness into her, and she'll live out her days in my body. Or I reject your authority, Sorrow. I will use the resonance to destroy you, and all of us will live free. God damn it! This is tough, folks. I reject your authority, Sorrow. I will use the resonant chamber, the resonance, to destroy you, and all of us will live free. The only one blameless in all of this is Mika, the mortal daughter of the changing god. Merge our consciousness into her, and she'll live out her days in my body. God damn it. But then again, if we started to fight her, can we even defeat the Sorrow? Well, with the help of the First, possibly. But I don't know if I want to... What we could, of course, do here is that first I choose this option and see what happens, and then if the game ends here, which seems very likely that this is the end of the game, and this is basically our final choice we make before the game ends. So after that, I reload the game and then pick this choice and see what happens after that. I think that's a good idea. So let's pick the 4th option here and see what happens. And if this game ends, I'm later gonna make another episode where I pick the 6th option and see what would happen, and see what would have happened there. All right, so let's take this. The only one blameless in all of this is Mika, the mortal daughter of the changing god. Merge our consciousness into her, and she'll live out her days in my body. Her? You choose the catalyst of this whole situation to survive? She is not blameless. Without her, we would have never have attracted Sorrow's attention in the first place. She has been dead for centuries, you fool. Give the gift to the living. The Sorrow pauses, evaluating you. You have lived your life compassionately and with sacrifice. Your answer does not come as a surprise, though your willingness to sacrifice the lives of all your siblings does. Tell me, why have you made this decision? She had nothing to do with this situation. She is innocent in all this. It was the changing god's fault, not hers. I can't blame the victim. She has been dead for centuries. Her life snatched away by forces beyond her control. I want to give her the chance to show her potential. It's my choice. I don't have to justify myself. I like the second one better. I want to give her the chance to show her potential. A fair answer. If this is your choice, then we shall commence with the solution. And the first castoff is not going to like it, I take it. Do you really think I'm going to stand by and let you make that decision? After all I have done for our kind, let me remind you that I am the first. You are the last. I should think that gives me precedence. I have fought against this creature for years, and I won't let the Sorrow erase us now. Well, if you think you can destroy her, then be my guest and go and try. She had nothing to do with this situation. She is innocent in all this. It was the changing god's fault, not hers. I can't blame the victim. What have we wrought? What great inventions have we made? The endless battles spilled out of your rage, and look what it became. My choice is final. Yeah, I like this. Oh. No. Your final choice is to die by my hand. She strides forward you with murder and her mask and begins to blaze with eldritch energies. But before she can come close to you, a shimmering black screen appears in the space between, writhing with worms of green force, and the sorrow's might shoves the first to her knees. Although she looks dead to me. The sorrow stretches its arms. Prepare yourself. The lights that dance through its form coalesce. The tormented minds that hang within it begin to stream away, drawn to some hidden singularity at the heart of the chamber. The sorrow dissolves, thread by thread, into that invisible hall, decohering into a lattice, a ring, a nearly comprehensible language of symbols and thoughts laying its purpose bare. A pure white light grows at the heart of the resonance, reaching towards you. The light envelops you in a soft embrace. The walls of the labyrinth collapse around you. You and the other castoffs become the singularity. And the minds of the castoffs trickle towards you. A torrent, a flood, a tsunami of experience and memories that stretch across centuries and worlds unimagined, and you remember it all. You remember it all. The pain and tragedy and suffering and triumph. All the modes and dreams of countless others trying to leave their mark on the world. Let the memories come. The torrent continues as you surrender control. The memories of castoffs you have met, the ones you will never meet, will fill your mind and overwhelm you. You taste their bitter notes and their sweet, and the knowledge of solitude and the depths of friends, every life, every love, every enemy. The first kiss, the first broken heart, the triumph of justice served, the ashen thrill of revenge realized. Sadness, joy, fear, anger, the secrets hidden and the truths revealed. All the memories and hopes congeal and compress, join in yours. They overwhelm you, a rising tide of demands and feels honed by centuries of life, drowning you with them. You surrender your identity, sinking into the resonance, and they sink with you, combining into a single sweet note. And then the memories are gone as you stream into Mika's mind and memories, filling her with the wisdom and experiences of your lives. You shut out sensation and thought, coiling in on yourself like a flower returning to its seed. And then, a great radiance surrounds your mind, an encompassing brilliance. You slip into oblivion, secure in the knowledge that some fraction of your life continues on. Oh. Okay. I was so sure that the game was going to end there. Not that... Oh, Tibir is here, but where is Matkina? When you open your... Oh yeah, we are all in the same body, yes, of course, and she was a castoff too. When you open your eyes, vertigo assails you. The sorrow hovers here, its tendrils coiling and twisting. You sit up, the detritus of the battle surrounds you, but you feel a quietness in the room, a lack. It takes you a moment, and then you realize the first is gone, and are all her allies, not just dead, but vanished utterly. The world is familiar, but you are seeing it through new eyes. You feel consciousness slipping away, as if sliding onto a tectonic plate. You are becoming Mika. The resonance is sealed, the tides once again at rest. Your father's final vessel has restored you to life, and all the castoffs are part of you now. Our journey is concluded. What happened to the last castoff? She chose to give her life for you. She allowed her mind to join those of her siblings in the resonance, and they created the foundation for your new life. What happened to my father? Lost, child. He spent his years trying to restore you to life. He has succeeded, though at the cost of his own. The sorrow pauses. I caution you against any attempts to restore him. Let his legacy be manifest in your person. Turn to the beer. What will you do now? Ah, damn it! If only, It's kind of a shame that I don't have any. That I didn't have any other characters, companions with me. Aligern, Eretis. God, I like Eretis. He was so much fun. Or Callisti. However you were supposed to spell her name. I didn't really have her with me. I only had her for like one episode, but that's pretty much it. So I didn't really learn much about her. Well, I guess that this just means that I must play this game once more, or maybe many more times in the future. Obviously, I didn't really expect to experience everything in one playthrough. So anyway, so Tibir, what will you do now?
If you need me, I'll be here, lad. Otherwise, I'll be looking for some distance from this whole mess.
Go now, choose a wiser path than your father did, and we will not meet again. The sorrow fades into the air, and then it's gone. You look away from the deceased patch of air, but this place is not much better. You are surrounded by blackened, bloody rubble. By death, it is time, perhaps for some fresh air. Taking a deep breath, you set off. The daughter of the changing god set out into the world he had. The daughter of the changing god set out into the world he had, without knowing mate for her. She traveled in the body that once belonged to the last castoff, and with a mind forged by sacrifice. You were remembered for your great acts of compassion and sacrifice. For years to come, tales of your life inspired the people of the Ninth World to follow the murmuring of their conscience and protect those who could not protect themselves. Why the In Exile's logo is here? It must be a bug of some kind. Ah, there we go. Aligern sought his friend Orth, but never found him. In despair, he journeyed west, through Algur, Kala, and into the Steadfast. None could provide him the answers he sought, and he became a dead-eyed mercenary, hurling his living tattoos with abandon. He was a haunted man. He never knew what became of his family, and he never stopped looking. On the day of his death, the tattoos he bore screamed aloud and disappeared. What became of Callisti, no one knows. Some say she wandered into the deserts around Zagus. Others say she was found dead on the street shortly after the most recent bloomquake. Another still say she wanders the known world, seeking something forever beyond reach. Tibir returned to Zagus Cliffs, bowed beneath the weight of his guilt and the loss of his lover Alvig. And bereft of any greater purpose, he rededicated himself to the myriad of schemes that had once sustained him, but they no longer did. Desperate to forget his failures, he buried himself in pleasure and took dangerous and despicable jobs to support his extravagant lifestyle. Near the end, he had no less than 5 contracts on his head, but the levies found him first. Guilty of crimes what would have once made him shudder, Tibir at last found himself before a jeering crowd and the executioner he had once feared. Death of Tibir. Eretis set off on his own, driven by the competing urges of the voices in his head, hungry for the grand quest would define his life and etch his story into the heavens. He changed rumors in circles, he lost in deserts and scaled mountains, he explored ruins, claimed artifacts, climbed and fell and swam and ran and collapsed. Months and months of unending adventure had taken the toll on the hero. Eretis died in a nameless field, not far from where he had begun his mad and frantic quest, and the voices within him went dormant, quiet, waiting for the next hero to come along. Rhin returned to her world content. She had rescued the one who had so kindly rescued her. In so doing, she brought closure to a significant part of her life. She would never forget the last castoff. As for the rest of her story, that has yet to be written. Ah, Rhin. The veterans of the Fifth Eye enjoyed their retirement from the psychic wars. They drank, they laughed, they retold the same tales to anyone who would listen, until one by one their minds faded and soon there was only Ziopi, drinking with her friends by herself. That was when the adversary, that ancient foe of the psychic veterans, chose to attack. It had hidden itself among the fifth eye patrons, watching and waiting with the other veterans gone. It emerged suddenly and without warning. An adversary devoured Siobis' mind, then it rampaged across the Sakus and Protectorate, unchallenged and free. I don't know who that was about. Fifth Eye? What? The quakes beneath Sakus' cliffs ceased for many years. Despite Belial's concerns that without leverage over them, the Sticka would return someday. She would stand in the square most days, preaching her fear to whoever would listen. One day, Belial announced that she had evidence that Sticka had returned. She called for a group of brave souls to follow her beneath the city, to stop them before it was too late. Several of her bravest listeners followed her into the dark. Nobody knows what has become of them. The Children of the Endless Gate ran rampant over the valley. Within a month, every memorialist and traveler had been killed, except for the hardiest of explorers. God damn it. Now, the caravaner will travel to the valley, and the necropolis has become a dungeon rather than a memorial. Late at night, the screams can be heard from as far as Corn Village. Well, goddammit, I thought I chased them away. The bloom was relatively quiet for days after the Soros attack on the Memorira's fortress. Nearly all of the Memorira's soldiers had fled, and the rest of the bloom's denizens waited quietly, wondering what would happen. When the Memorira did not return, and nobody rose up to take her place, that's when the fighting began. It started with the mutants of Little Nihlish, but soon every faction was involved. The bloom became a deadly battleground, one the bloom itself seemed to encourage, engorging itself on the lust of its denizens. Bruska harbored a small continent of civilians inside the fortress, hoping that the violence would die down. They are still there, hoping. Ah, so Bruska was, in the end, a nice person. Yeah. Cody waited loyally for the last castoff return. Oh shit, I completely forgot about him. But he never did. After a while, the slavers started looking at him suspiciously, afraid that they would try to sell him again. He ran. Nobody knows where he went or what became of him. Arda Clio and his troop remained in Surgeon's Slump, free from the desires of the Maw. Arda Clio became more jovial, friendly even. He drank less and extorted less, though he still extorted, of course. A man's got to make a living somehow. When the troubles in the bloom started, Arda Clio and his men barricaded Surgeon's Slump. They are still there, though the bloom itself tears down every barricade they erect. They simply build another one, making sure the slump, at least, remains safe. The ruins of Miel Aves lie broken, untouched. It is more than a century before a group of explorers stumble upon them, wondering what happened in this place. What in the ninth world could have caused so much destruction? Alright, was that all? And that was the end of the game, then, apparently. And I must admit, I'm a little bit disappointed. Because this game ended quite a lot faster than I expected it, really. I've only played this game for 33, maybe 34, maybe 35 hours or so. So not a whole lot. The only explanation for that I can think of is that I have missed some of the content. Well, obviously I've missed some content. But I think I missed more content than I thought I did. Because we were only in a few places, in locations. We were in Sakus Cliffs, and then we went to the valley, the necropolis, and then Miel Avest, and then the bloom, and then every once in a while we were in the labyrinth. But that's pretty much it. That's like, what, 5-6 different locations in total where we have been during this entire game, and that's very, very little. So I really hope that there are much more other areas, many more quests and other characters to interact with and talk to, and yeah, I hope that there is a heck of a lot more in this game than just this, because if there isn't, then I must say I'm quite disappointed, really. But I don't want to judge this game too much just yet, because. Well, this was the first playthrough, and I never review or give any final opinions or judgments on an old school role playing game like this, before I have played this, before I have played the game more than once. Because if you have, because unless you have played the game more than once, like 3-4 times, or ideally even more, and you have pretty much explored at least most of the content, and then and only then can you really say that whether they have succeeded in making a very good role playing game with lots of replay value and stuff like that. So yeah, this let's play ended a lot earlier than I expected it to, and I expected that the world would be a lot bigger place. Really, I have seen the map of the Ninth World, or at least the map of the part of the Ninth World where we're supposed to adventure around, and we haven't been in. We haven't visited like 70% of the map, or maybe even more. I don't know if I'm explaining myself well, I have seen the map of this world or the world where we are supposed to be able to go to in this game. I saw the Sacus Cliffs, the Bloom, and so on and so forth. And so far, indeed, I think we haven't been in like 70-80% of the map. And also, I have heard that many people have been saying that In Exile Entertainment had cut off some content from this game, like certain locations, maybe some features and stuff like that. And speaking about features, like I have said in a few times, this game still felt like it was in beta. Like for example, in crisis situations, like the portraits that we saw above here, the portraits looked like placeholder portraits. The only real portraits that were shown were ours and our party members, and that's it. The others just looked like poor placeholder portraits you would see in a beta or alpha or some kind. And what about the story itself? Well, the story was very intriguing and interesting. I also found the very areas, like the Bloom especially, was very intriguing and fascinating. The characters, well, I can't say too much about the characters because we only had like half, because I only got to know a few of them rather as well. Matkina, Tubir, and Rhin. Those are the only ones I can really talk about, because the rest, Aligern, Eritis, and Kalishti, I didn't really learn too much about them because they were not in my party for long, especially Kalishti. And I didn't talk too much with Eritis or Aligern, or have many adventures with them in the end. So I can't say too much about them, but what I can say about Matkina and Rhin are perhaps my favorite. Well, Eritis was also my favorite already, because he was very fun and hilarious character. But anyway, I really liked Rhin. She's perhaps my most favorite character in this game, and I really liked how she came and helped us in our last quest. In my mind, I don't know how she got there. I don't care. She's awesome. Matkina was also rather interesting character with her own conflicts and demons she must have had to deal with. Tubir wasn't really that interesting, and not really anything new really. I'm quite sure that there are many other games or even books or movies where you have met Tubir like type of character. So that's why I wasn't too intrigued by him. Plus he sucked as a tank. What else? Oh yeah, I was still talking about the cut content. So according to what I have heard, In Exile did cut some content away from this game. The stretch goals that they reached in the Kickstarter campaign, but I don't know which ones. Oh yeah, I think someone wrote that they cut off their crafting system, and that seems to be the case, because There certainly didn't seem to be any crafting system in this game, or if there was, then I missed it completely. But I hardly doubt I could have missed it. I'm quite sure that the game would have given me a tutorial about the, or at least would have given me a tip about the crafting system if there ever was any in this game. So anyway, there's quite obviously no crafting system in this game, even though there was supposed to be, and that was one of the cutted features. And they also cut off some of the companions that they were going to add in this game. But I actually read quite recently from somewhere that In Exile is going to add more content to this game, and they are soon going to add a new party member, which from what I remember is basically going to be a blob of goo, or was it jelly or something like that, I don't know. That sounded weird to say the least, but whatever the case, In Exile have announced that they are going to add more content to this game, and the next one is going to be a new party member, and I don't know, maybe some more quests or stuff like that, I don't remember anymore. But yeah, I have very conflicting feelings about this game. It has great potential. I had very good time playing it, and the story was very intriguing and interesting indeed. The characters also were also interesting to listen to, and I really wanted to learn more about this world. So the Monte Cook's Numenera setting is very interesting, and I really hope that the story would have continued a lot longer, because it kind of feels like I've only played like half of the game, or maybe one third of the game. I don't really think that this game should have ended here. Because I think I have learned only so little, and again I have only been in 5 unique locations, like Sakus Cliffs, the valley with the necropolis, Miel Avest, the Bloom, and so on and so forth. So yeah, the only hope that I have is that In Exile is going to add more content to this game as the time goes on. Why they cut off certain features like the crafting system, some companions, and potentially some other areas that they were planning to add to the game, but they didn't. I don't know why they removed them. Maybe it was because they couldn't add them in time before the deadline, or they were running out of funds already, and they didn't want to go with budget. I don't know, but whatever the reason is, I really hope that they do add more content to this game as time goes on, for free preferably, because I think we deserve that. But knowing In Exile, I'm quite sure that they are going to add more content to this game for free. I mean, heck, they gave Wasteland 2 Director's Cut Edition to everyone who owned Wasteland 2 already for free. So I'm very positive that they are going to update and add more features, companions, quests, areas, and locations to this game for free. I'm very positive. But as right now, I think it's lacking a little bit in content. And it still felt like it was in beta stage in a sense, when it came to the portraits and the lack of portraits in the dialogue UI, and every once in a while there was this In Exile half period In Exile logo here as you saw just earlier. But yeah, but that's something they can easily fix. Nothing they can't fix. But yeah, I don't really have anything else to say about this game. I would really have to play this game a couple of more times at least. Make very different characters, make different choices, and use different companions, and try to go to different places and such before I can give any final opinions and judgments that whether this is a good role-playing game right now as right now as it is. But to sum it up, I'm a little bit disappointed, and I think that this game lacks content. I really believe that there was going to be some more, and I really believe that this game was going to last a lot longer than only 35 or so hours. But yeah, that's what I think about this game so far. I'm glad that I played it. It has a very interesting story and interesting characters and stuff like that. But yeah, I'm just repeating myself right now. So I'm just gonna stop this episode here. And Planescape Torment Enhanced Edition is supposed to come out next month. I don't remember the date anymore. Was it 12th or 18th of April? I must be confusing it with Full Throttle's remasters release. But anyway, I don't know if I'm going to play Planescape Torment Enhanced Edition when it comes out, but I do want to play that. I do want to play that game very soon after it comes out. But before that, I'm going to start a new Let's Play, a new CRPG, possibly today. So stay tuned for that. Now then, thank you very 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 much for watching my Let's Play Torment: Tides of Numenera, and I might make a second playthrough of this game, but not for a fair long while, because there are lots of other role playing games that I still want to play. So anyway, I'm rambling too much. So thank you for watching my Let's Play Torment: Tides of Numenera, and see you in the next one.